Andrea Mills here. Today I want to talk to you guys about the very basics of sewing with a sewing machine. So this month's theme is going to be doing sewing videos, and I thought to myself, you never know how things go, so if I only got to make one video, what would be the most important video? And this, I think, is the one, because there have been so many of you who have said that you either have a sewing machine or you want to get one, but you have no idea what to do with it once you have it. So today we're gonna just look over the machine, and I'm gonna give you some pointers on getting started. I don't know how basic you need this to be, so I figured I would just do this with you like I do with my own kids when they start learning to sew. Then we'll do a little sewing practice. Then we're gonna talk about some of the common problems that you're probably gonna run into and what to do when that happens. And then finally, we will go ahead and make a tablecloth together, because I need to make some tablecloths. So, and they're super simple, so that's going to be the project. But one of the blessings of sewing is that you get to be creative. We all have an innate need to do creative things. It also is productive, because we actually can make things that are useful for our homes. I don't think there's a room in my house that doesn't have things that I've sewn. I sew a lot of the clothes that we wear, like all the curtains in my house I've made, most of the blankets I've made sheets and pillowcases, and I'm sure other things that are just not even coming to mind at the moment. Sewing is also an excellent method of learning to be patient, because we have to take our time, and we are definitely gonna make mistakes that have to be redone. So this is a good method of heart training as well. So I have a Brother sewing machine, and I got this one just because it was not very expensive when I needed to replace my old one. This is has more of electronic features, but they also have an even less expensive one that just has dials, and they both work fine. Until you get into like major projects, any sewing machine is going to do the job for what you need it to do for most basic things. Okay, so this is basically how a sewing machine works. You have thread that's coming from your needle going down into the fabric, and then you're going to have a bobbin underneath that's also feeding thread in, and that thread catches with the needle thread. So every time the needle goes down into the fabric, it catches this bobbin thread and keeps it from pulling back out of the fabric. And it just keeps going, and that's what holds the thread into the fabric. So when you get done, you should have a nice smooth stitch pattern on both sides of your fabric, just like that. So here on the side we have the power switch, and this is the power cord, and in the back there is where we plug in the foot pedal. Here's my foot pedal on the floor, and it works just like the gas pedal of a car. The harder you push, the faster it goes. Let's just talk about the parts here. The thread goes here. When you're going to wind thread onto the bobbin would go here, and this piece moves like that. That's what actually triggers the machine to start winding the bobbin. Otherwise, this will stay still while you're sewing. And then this is kind of the guide to make sure that the thread winds smoothly on the bobbin. This is the thread guide that you use, this piece of it when you are sewing, and when you're winding a bobbin you'll use this piece, and I'll show you how to do that in a little bit. This is a tension control, and all sewing machines are a little different, but they all have these same basic parts. So this controls how much tension is on the thread as it comes out of the needle, so that it doesn't come off too fast or too slow. Then these grooves are where the thread comes down and loops around. Is this little lever inside that goes up and down with the needle, and that holds the thread and helps it go up and down. Then it comes down and gets hooked through this little thread guide, and then finally down into the needle right here. This machine has this thing that can thread the needle for you, and I've practiced it many times, and I always forget how to do it, so I usually just do it the old-fashioned way with my fingers. This machine also has a little cutting blade, so you can just pull your thread through there to cut it. Okay, on the side, this is the hand wheel, and it turns like that, and it makes the needle go up and down if you need to just move it a little bit. This one has a digital stitch selector, so this moves that number up and down. This button does that one. and those correspond with these, this stitch guide over here. So you just pick, if I want number 24, then I would move this to number 2 and number 4. Yours might have a dial that you have to turn to get the stitch you want. And then this one, it's kind of hard to see here, but this is for how long you want the stitch. So this is set at 2.5, and if I want a longer stitch, I can push that way, or a shorter stitch. And again, yours might have a dial that changes that. And then this is for stitches that are a zigzag. It changes how wide the zigzag is. Sewing machines have a little removable kind of drawer thing right here, and it usually comes with a little pouch inside that has like tools that you might need, like a screwdriver, maybe some extra needles and bobbins, a seam ripper, maybe some oil might be in there too. I usually take this off if I'm doing sleeves or something that are really tight and I need a smaller, I need to like get it over this, then you can take that off. Otherwise I keep it on because it's a little easier to guide the fabric through with it on. Under here, this is the little lever that you use to raise and lower the presser foot. Just like that. You have it up to get your fabric in and out, and when you're ready to sew, you put it down to hold the fabric in place. The presser foot is usually removable. Mine has a little lever here in the back that if I just pick it up, it falls off, and you can change these out if you want to do some special kind of work. I rarely ever change mine because I don't ever do anything fancy. This is the knob that you turn to change out your needle. So you just loosen it and then your needle will come out. Needles have one flat side on them so that you can make sure to get it in the right direction every time. It'll only go in one way. Back here is the little lever thing that you use when you're using the buttonhole feature. My machine, the light bulb comes on automatically when you turn it on, but some machines have a separate switch to turn the light off and on. Under here are these little metal teeth, and they are the things that kind of grab the fabric and scoot it through the machine. These are little guides, so you can line your fabric up to the one of these, depending on where you want to put your seam, so that it helps you sew straight. And then this is where you put the bobbin thread, so this pops out. Yours might be a little different, but the bobbin sits right down in there. Then we thread it through and start sewing. Now my bobbin has to be put in a certain direction or it won't work correctly. So, but some machines have like a little case that you actually put the bobbin in and put in, and then it doesn't matter. I don't think it matters which way it goes. One more thing is the reverse button. So mine has just a button. Some machines have like a lever somewhere that you pull up and or push down, but this is how you go backward while you're sewing. You actually have to hold it in the whole time too. If you let go, then it starts going forward again. So the whole time you're wanting to sew backward, you keep it pressed or keep the lever pushed down. Okay, so the first thing that we're gonna do, now that you've seen basically what all the parts are for, then I'm gonna have you get a piece of paper, and if you want, you can get a piece of tape. And we're gonna practice sewing on paper without any thread in the machine. Just drive around on the paper and mess around with all of the buttons and knobs and just get a feel for using the presser foot, like how fast you go, guiding the paper with your hands, and try out the different stitches, and try the reverse button. If you want, you can draw some pictures on your piece of paper and sew along the lines and just get comfortable using the machine without having to worry about actually accomplishing something or tangling something up. You can also put down a piece of tape to mark where you want the edge of your paper to be, so you can practice sewing some straight seams. When I'm sewing, I either use the edge of my presser foot for a half inch seam, or most patterns call for a 5/8 inch seam, which you can kind of see it. Sorry. You can kind of see that it's marked up here where that line would be, but for right now it doesn't matter. You just kind of pick a spot and practice. Okay, so we're going to use our hand wheel and make sure that our needle is up at the highest position so we can get our paper in there, and then get the paper wherever you want to start. I'm going to go ahead and put mine along the tape here. Use that to lower, I can't remember the name of this little thing. I'm sure it has a good name, but anyways, we're going to lower the presser foot and then start pressing down on
the foot pedal to make the machine go. We can push really hard to see what happens when we do that. We could try a zigzag to see what that looks like.
And just practice keeping your paper straight. We can change the stitch length or sew in a big crazy circle. This is helping to learn how to use your hands to guide, like your steering wheel to guide your fabric through or your paper through. Let's try the reverse. All right, I've got my button held in now and I'm going to go backwards. When you're done sewing and you want to take the paper out, then you're going to turn the hand wheel to raise the needle. And then lift up the presser foot and you can pull it out. Just keep doing that until you feel very comfortable that you understand how all the different buttons and switches work. And you feel really comfortable with the foot pedal and all that. Once you've done that and you're ready to move on, then I'm going to show you how to wind a bobbin and how to thread the machine. Most machines have some directions on the top to show you, so in case you forget from time to time, you also can look in your manual and it'll show you exactly what to do. For doing the bobbin, we'll do that first. We need to start with thread on the machine. Then let's follow the guide. It says number one, we're supposed to go this direction around this little tension knob. Make sure it's in there nice and tight. Then we're supposed to come back over here and we're supposed to put the thread through the little hole right here. And I can't do that while I'm holding the camera, so just a second. Okay, so I actually took that off to do it because it's way easier to hold it in your hand and then put it on once you got the thread through. Okay, so you can see how it is. I came in from the bottom side there and then I came up through the hole. I'm gonna hang on to this thread for the first little bit and then I'm gonna trim it once we get good and going. Once it's all ready like this, we push it over and that will switch the machine to winding the bobbin rather than making the needle go. Then it's just a matter of pushing the foot pedal down, our little gas pedal at the bottom, and just keep it going until it stops by itself. When the bobbin gets full, it'll stop on its own. So hang on to that thread. Now that it's kind of started good, I'm gonna actually stop and trim this off so I don't have to keep holding it the whole time. Okay, so it stopped spinning, so now it's all done. And then I'm just gonna cut the thread. And now I have my bobbin thread and my regular thread. Push the lever back over and pop it off. And then we can load it in to the machine. So I'm gonna take that off. Now, you can see mine says that the thread needs to be coming off the left side here. So I'm gonna make sure that I'm holding it so that the thread's to the left and just rest right down in here. Now when you buy bobbins, different machines use different kinds, although there's only a few different ones. So if you're not sure and you want to get extra bobbins, just take one of these with you to the store and make sure that you get the right kind. Okay, so it's down in there. Then we take our thread and just pull it through here. And your machine might be a little different, but you can see it's got little arrows guiding me that that's where I need to pull it.
And I just pull it right over here and just leave it for a second. Now it's time to thread the machine. So I'll take that off of the little tension knob, and now I'm going to follow the directions for threading the machine. You'll see that the directions for the bobbin have a dotted line, and the ones for the regular sewing have the solid line. So number one, I need to take my thread and come up under there and through that. Then tells me to keep going. Now this part's harder to see, but there's a number two that with an arrow down to keep going down. And then we have a number three showing us that we're going to loop around here, go up, and number four is to catch it in that lever. So I'm going to turn my hand wheel to bring it up. It's very hard to see it, but it's going to go back behind and loop around so that I want to make sure that that thing has grabbed it. And then I'm going to keep going down, number five, keep going down. And then we're going to come way back there, and there's this little tiny thing right here that we need to go behind. Then it's time to thread the needle, and we want to thread the hole going from front to back, not back to front. So make sure you go through the front side of the hole and make sure that the thread doesn't twist around the needle, which sometimes happens. If it does, just undo it and try again. Right here is where it can sometimes loop around and twist, but we got it through.
The next step is to take the thread and go through that little split right there and pull it to the back. Now we need to get the two threads locked together. So I'm going to hang on to this, and I'm going to turn the hand wheel, and you'll see this thread come and loop around this thread and grab it. See if I can do this with one hand while I hold the camera. I'm turning the hand wheel. It's coming down. You'll see the thread go across the top of the bobbin and grab that bobbin thread. And once it comes all the way back up, I'm going to take my scissors and slide that under. And that should bring both my threads up so that the bobbin thread is now coming out of this little hole right here. If you don't get it the first time, just keep trying and go slow and look what you're doing and you'll figure it out. So now I got both my threads out here. I'm going to put my cover back on my bobbin. And we are ready to start sewing. So just like we did before, we're going to use our paper, put it in, lower the presser foot, and just do some practice sewing. Do the same thing we did without the needle or without the thread, and just have fun trying out different stitches and seeing what it looks like. Then remember when you're done sewing that you're going to lift your presser foot. You need to make sure to turn the hand wheel to bring the needle up. And then that'll also unlock the thread so that you can pull it. This time you're going to have threads attached. So you're going to cut your threads, but you're going to make sure to do it far away from the machine. Because if you cut close to here, when you start to sew again, it will want to unthread your machine, which will be annoying. So make sure that you cut far away when you are trimming your threads. One difference between sewing on a machine and sewing by hand is that there are no ways to make a knot on the machine. So usually when you are sewing something like a piece of clothing and you want to make sure that your stitches don't come out, especially in high stress areas of the clothes, you will backstitch at the beginning and end of each seam that you sew. That just means that you're gonna start sewing and you are going to go a few stitches. There's no like rule about how far, but just go a few stitches. Then you're gonna push the back button and sew backwards that same distance and then start going forward, and that's the equivalent of tying your knot. So before you start doing any other sewing, go ahead and practice doing a back stitch.
This time I'm gonna line up my paper to the edge of the presser foot, and I'm gonna sew a straight stitch, but I'm gonna back stitch once I get started. Let up and ready to go.
So my little flowers didn't turn out very good because at first I was just being patient, and then I started trying to push the paper. You can see that it did not turn out well, so I learned something myself today on using my own machine. So let's talk for a minute about some other important tools that you're going to need for sewing besides just your sewing machine and your bobbins and your thread.
You will need some sort of oil, and this is sold right with all the other sewing supplies. And every few months or so, I put a few drops of oil. I just kind of drop it right down in there and move my hand wheel to kind of jiggle it around. And then I usually sew on either a fabric scrap or a piece of paper, just in case some oil gets all the way down and drips. Then I can clean that up before I put any nice fabric in. Of course, you'll need a pair of scissors, and you'll need a nice big pair for cutting fabric, and if you want, you can have a little pair that is nice for getting into little nooks and crannies, but I usually just use these ones. You will need some pins to hold things together, and I think these are plastic pins. If you get glass ones, you can use the iron on them without hurting them. If you have plastic ones, you'll want to be careful when you're ironing, otherwise you'll melt the pin heads. You will need a regular sewing needle, because there are many times when you'll save yourself a lot of aggravation if you just hand stitch some of the more delicate areas or some of the finishing work rather than trying to do it on the machine. You will also need extra needles for your machine. They have different sizes. There's a little chart on the back to tell you the number and what kind of fabric that you are sewing with. I usually just stick with one of the midweight needles. Unless I'm really sewing something heavy duty, then I'll switch to that, to a thicker needle size. But generally, if you just stick with the mid-size ones, especially when you're new, you're not gonna need to worry about these other kinds of needles. These are for very fine fabrics. And like when I sew through cardboard, making Halloween costumes and things, I definitely wanna use the heavyweight needle, but usually that one's just fine. So extras of those, and you will not function well without a seam ripper. This is to undo all the things that you did that you didn't mean to do. So this is a little blade right here in the curve, and you poke this up into the fabric or up under the threads. I'll show you here how it works. So you go up under the thread and then do that, and it cuts the threads so that you can take them out and get rid of the problem and start over again.
You seriously cannot live without a seam ripper, so make sure to get one of those. The last thing that you definitely want to have is an iron. Ironing as you go makes a huge difference in the quality of what you do. For me, ironing is like 30% at least of my sewing time is actually spent with ironing things, because pressing out seams and just doing a nice job just makes everything look so much better. So definitely plan on having an iron accessible if you can. Obviously, if you can't, you just do your best with what you got. But if you have one, get in the habit of making use of it while you're sewing. So let's talk about some of the things that are likely to go wrong while you're sewing. The first one I've already kind of mentioned, which is when you start sewing, when your needle comes up, the thread just pulls out and it's super annoying. So what you need to do is just make sure before you start sewing that you have a nice long tail on your thread. Pull it out nice and far, and then keep your hand on it while you begin sewing. So the quick action of the machine, when it pops up the first time, it won't unthread the needle. Another common problem is that when you get done sewing, you have really loopy threads on the bottom of the fabric. Instead of it looking nice and neat on both sides, the top might look nice. It might not even look nice either, but the bottom will definitely have these big loopy threads. Usually, well, not usually, that's always going to be a tension problem. You can check to make sure that the tension knob isn't too loose here. I usually keep mine set on 4, so maybe you might have yours turned down too low or too high for your fabric, so you can try that. Sometimes it's the bobbin tension, and that just means that you need to thread the bobbin. So just pull it out of here and then thread it back through and do the little process of getting it back up through the hole again, and that will usually fix that problem. Some machines have a separate tension on the bobbin if you have a little case, but I'm not sure how to adjust that, so you'd have to look up about how to do that. Sometimes it's a problem up here with the tension, like it's not threaded properly here, so just take your thread off or unthread the whole machine and then just thread it again, and that usually resolves it. Okay, so sometimes you're sewing and the fabric won't go through. Those little feed dog teeth, they're what pull the fabric through. But I usually have my hands on the fabric and I do kind of gently help it go along. But sometimes, especially when you're first starting a seam, it just won't go. That's usually because the fabric is kind of flimsy and so it's having a hard time grabbing it and pulling it through. So what I usually do is stop sewing, lift up the presser foot and just start a little further down and then backstitch all the way back as far as I want to go, and that usually helps it get going. If you keep sewing in the same spot too long, you'll get a big knot of thread, and then you might have to like get your little scissors and cut your fabric out of the machine, and then you'll have a hole. Believe me, this has happened to me many times before. So if it does happen, you know what, life goes on. But if you can help it, try to recognize quickly that it's not moving and just get your fabric or get your seam started in a different spot and then go back to get that end that was hard to get through. One of the annoying things that happens when you're sewing is that your bobbin thread might run out and you don't notice, and you sew a big long seam and then you get all done and it's not sewed because there's been no bobbin thread. So obviously, like, this machine has a clear cover so I can kind of pay attention better, but you have to just like get attuned to the sound, because the sound changes, the pitch changes when the bobbin thread runs out. It just sounds different. So the more you sew and start trying to pay attention, then you'll kind of notice when it runs out. And also just remember to just take a glance every once in a while and look and make sure it's still sewing, and you don't like sew a big long side of a quilt or something and then find out that you didn't have any bobbin thread the whole time. When you're winding your bobbin on the top, if it ends up all loopy, the thread, that's probably again a tension problem, and that when you started winding, if you don't hold that thread nice and tight long enough, then it will get loose when it starts, and then the whole bobbin will end up with loopy loose thread. So if that happens, you just need to take the thread all off and start over again, because if you try sewing with it that way, it'll mess up the tension on your sewing. So then you just have a bunch of loopy problems on your seam, and that's no fun. So if you notice that you come out with a bobbin with loopy thread, just undo it and try again. If you're careful, you can wind it back onto your spool of thread and then start over, so you don't have to waste the thread. If you break a needle, sometimes it happens from sewing over like a pin when you're sewing. You're supposed to take the pins out when you're sewing, but a lot of times it's so much easier to leave them in and just hope that you miss them, and you usually do, so you're usually fine. Sometimes you actually hit it and it breaks your needle, so just get a new needle and put it in. Sometimes it's because you're sewing through something really thick. That happened to Judah the other day when he was working on a project. He was sewing through something really thick and it broke the needle, so it's like, oh, we need to put one of those heavy duty needles in for this project. If the machine just seizes up and won't sew at all, that could be a couple of problems, but one of them might be that it needs oiled, and when it needs oiled and you haven't oiled it for a while, it will seize up the machine. I know this from experience, and just putting some oil in, it's good to go again. Sometimes it's because a thread is caught and it's not going. And if that happens, you know, you have to kind of jimmy your fabric back out, which can be difficult to do, and trim out the mess and start over again. Sometimes there might be thread stuck inside the bobbin area, so you might need to take the lid off and make sure there's no loose threads in there that somehow got stuck. This machine has an error code that will pop up when there's an error, and I can look in my manual and see what that means, and it will tell me what to do. So I assume that most newer machines have something like that. If you don't have your manual for your machine, you can find them online probably for just about any machine, so just look them up on there. But I keep mine right here by my sewing machine because it's full of all sorts of useful information, especially when there's a problem. Okay, so now it's time to get started on our tablecloths. Years ago, I made a couple of birthday tablecloths for our table, but then when Tom built us a new really long table, I needed to make new tablecloths. So I bought the fabric, but I never have hemmed them yet. So even though we've had two birthdays since then, but today's going to be the day I'm going to hem those up, and this is a nice, easy project for beginners.
So these are the two fabrics that we picked out for our birthday tablecloths. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first use my iron, and I'm going to fold this about a half inch in, and I'm going to iron all the way around the whole piece of fabric. I already have it cut to the size we need for our table. After I do it one time around, I'm going to fold it a second time and iron it again, so it'll look like that all the way around. So I press the hem all the way around.
That took me about three times longer than it will take to sew it. So now I'm going to just sew a straight stitch all the way around the tablecloth. I want to make sure that my hem or my stitching is the same distance from the edge all the way around. I'm just going to put the edge of my fabric to the edge of my presser foot and use that as my guide. I'm just going to try to keep it nice and straight as it goes in. Now, don't be watching the needle too much because then you're going to get crooked. You want to be watching down here and making sure that you're keeping this in line. This is the main focus of what you're going to be looking at while you sew.
Doesn't matter where you start at on this project. I'm going to start in the middle of one of the sides, and I'm going to do a few stitches, then back stitch, and then start going.
Okay, when I get to the corner, I'm going to go in and stop about that far from the edge. Then I'm going to lift my presser foot, turn my fabric, and hopefully it'll be about in the spot I want it already, and then just start sewing again. I've just about made it back to the start, so I'm going to finish sewing this and let it overlap a little, do a little back stitch, and then it'll be done. All that's left is to trim off the threads. And we have our finished tablecloth. Lesson on how to get started with your sewing machine. I hope that you'll be brave enough to get it out and give it a try, especially with some paper with no thread. Just get to know your machine and be brave. If you get stumped by something, don't be afraid to Google it. I Google everything, or I look it up on YouTube when I have a problem or I can't figure out how to do something. There's always somebody out there that's going to show you what you need to know. So don't be afraid to get in there, make mistakes, find somebody who will tell you what you need to do if you need help, and just have fun learning your machine. This is the perfect opportunity, again, to learn patience and to be gentle with yourself, because you're going to mess up a lot. And from practice, not berating yourself, not feeling bad about it, but just know that this is a learning experience. In fact, all of life is a time of learning for God to turn us into the kind of people He wants us to be. So your sewing projects are going to help refine you as a person, not just make nice things for your house. So I want to thank you guys for coming over today and having this fun time with me. If you're new to my channel, Tom and I have 8 children that we homeschool, and we have a home business, we do home church, we like to do home births, and on this channel we put up homeschool vlogs and shop with me videos, and then every month I try to have a different theme of something that we can focus on and learn together. So this month it's sewing, last month it was on herbal medicine. There's going to be a lot of other themes in the future, so I hope you'll consider subscribing. And one way or the other, thank you guys for coming over, and I'll see you guys again very soon.